Hello and welcome to Unpacking Terms. The term we're going to be unpacking today is developmental sequences. It touches on a few things we already unpacked, so you'll see throughout the video that I reference other videos and the links will pop up right here so you can go and check them out if you haven't yet. And what I'll present here is a summarized version of the work by many SLA scholars, but particularly Pinneman, Lightbaum, and Krashen. So what are developmental sequences? To put it simply, they are stages of progress in the acquisition of a language feature. And by that, we mean a grammar structure. These sequences have been determined based on spontaneous speech, and they have been documented for some features in some languages, not everything. So what does this path look like? For example, in the case of negation, you might hear learners go from "I know play" to "I know can play" to "I don't can play" and eventually "I can't play." And there are a couple of hypotheses connected to these developmental sequences. The first one is Krashen's natural order hypothesis, which is based on research done in the 70s with both adults and children acquiring English. And the natural order hypothesis says that the acquisition of language features follows a certain path regardless of the first language and regardless of instruction. And let's remember here what we unpacked in a previous video. Krashen is in the no interface camp when it comes to explicit and implicit knowledge. So to him, explicit learning leads only to explicit knowledge, and therefore it doesn't change the order or the speed of acquisition, which is implicit. And then we have Pinneman's teachability hypothesis, which is more along the lines of the weak interface position, which we also unpacked in that video. And it acknowledges a potential role for instructional intervention, but with some limits. For Pinneman, the effects of instruction are constrained by the learner's current state of development. That's why it's called the teachability hypothesis, meaning that teaching could have an effect, but it depends on the level of readiness of the learner. And this is also connected to what we discussed in the article on potential benefits of written corrective feedback. If you recall, Polio says that the feedback needs to be at the right level for the students. Now, Pinneman and Krashen don't agree with respect to the role of instructional intervention, such as focus on form, which we also unpacked in another video. But they do agree that instruction cannot change the order or the path of acquisition. So for example, just because you know the rule or somebody teaches you a grammar rule, that doesn't mean that you're going to be skipping stages. Now, I said order, I didn't say speed. So could feedback, for example, or focus on form help learners move faster through the stages? Well, that depends on who you ask. Again, this goes back to the issue of implicit versus explicit knowledge and whether there is any kind of connection or interface between them. What the experts don't fully agree on is the role of focus on form singular. Some of them think that it might help, and some of them think that it only leads to explicit knowledge and it doesn't affect acquisition. And yes, we defined acquisition in another video, so feel free to go take a look and then come back to this video. What else do we know? We know that progress is not uniform, and I probably don't have to work too hard to convince you about that. We know that learners move at different speeds through the stages, but the general path is the same. What might happen is that some learners move very quickly through one stage that you don't even notice it. So it looks like they skipped stages, but scholars maintain that no, they still follow the same path. It's just that they moved very quickly through some of the stages. As for the influence of the first language or any other languages that the learner may already know, the consensus appears to be that it might influence speed, but not order. Again, what might happen is that some learners pass through the stages very quickly thanks to their first language, but the order is still the same, and scholars maintain that the order is not influenced by the first language because research has shown that learners of different first languages appear to progress through the same stages, regardless of the first language. In, there are things we don't know. First, we don't know the order for all features of all languages. Like I said, it's only been documented for some languages. And something else we don't know is how to objectively determine the current stage of each learner. How do we determine when they're ready to acquire a particular feature? And these are the main reasons why we should be careful about how we try to apply what we know about developmental sequences to the classroom. The most important pedagogical implication I can give you is that it is not about what to teach when. Research on developmental sequences was never meant to be applied that way. And so why is this good for educators to know? Because of what Leibbaum said in the very first article we unpacked, and it's such a good quote that it's worth repeating. And it says, "The value of developmental sequences research is in helping teachers adapt their expectations of how progress can be seen in something other than an increase in accuracy. Indeed, some stages don't look like progress because there isn't necessarily an increase in accuracy, and yet the learners are making progress. So if a learner is going from saying, I know can play, to I don't can play, you might think they're not making progress. However, they are, because in developmental sequences, this tells us that they're getting closer and closer and closer to the target. And so, in a way, knowing about developmental sequences is about appreciating the journey as opposed to focusing only on the destination. Just because you don't see a flower yet, that doesn't mean the tiny growing leaves aren't worth appreciating. There's still a lot more to unpack, so be sure to subscribe. Thank you for tuning in, and until next time.